Welcome to Resonant Community Church. We're so glad each and every one of you can be with us today. But you dads out there, next weekend is Father's Day and we've got something really special for you. If you guessed tacos, you'd actually be right. We're giving you free tacos just to say thanks for being such a great dad. So stop by Taco Loco on First Avenue in Shakopee this coming Thursday night from 6 to 7 p.m. and we'll hand you a taco coupon that you can use that night or whenever you want. Happy early Father's Day from your friends at Resonate. We're also excited to announce in-person meetups for Resonate people that are happening at various times over the next few weeks. We hope you'll take advantage of these outings that are designed to be a fun time for you to reconnect with others from our church prior to services reopening down the road. You can find information about all these events and everything else going on around Resonate at resonatebuzz.com. We hope you're excited about what God is doing in your life today. Wherever you are, we're glad you're here. And now, let's worship together.
creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you.
Well, hi, everybody. My name is Curtis. So glad you're here today at Resonate Community Church. We're in week three of our message series called Happiness Is. And if you've missed a week or this is your first time with us, don't worry, I'll get you caught up real quick. In week one, we looked at how happiness is found in no thing. We learned that happiness is really about how you handle relationships. And if you have everything you want, but you've got relational difficulty, you will be unhappy. And which means happiness is more about a who than a what. That's what we learned in week one. Happiness is more about a who than a what. That was week one. Last week we saw that happiness is an outcome. Happiness is about sowing, S-O-W-I-N-G. There's sowing, which is planting, and there's reaping, which is harvesting, and happiness is about sowing. We sow our way into unhappiness. We don't just wake up one day and we're all of a sudden unhappy. And so it takes a lot of doing the wrong thing for a long period of time to become unhappy. And that means we sow ourselves into happiness as well. Happiness is the outcome of starting and then continuing to do the right thing over a period of time. Next week, we're actually going to take a break from this series for Father's Day, and we're going to have a special message by our director of music, Matt Klein, who incidentally is a brand new father as of this morning. So that's going to be a great time. I hope you can be here for that. But as we dive in today, we're going to look at something that happy people have in common, and that is that happy people all have peace. Yeah, you probably noticed this, haven't you? You know, if you have peace, you're happy. Maybe you've met somebody and there's nothing in their background that would suggest that they should have a peaceful life. Maybe they haven't had that great of an upbringing. Maybe they've had some things happen in their life that aren't the greatest, but they're happy. They're happy because they have found a way to be at peace with everything that's happened and everybody who's been a part of everything that's happened to them in their life, which means that if you have everything else that would make you happy or everything else that everybody says should make you happy, but you don't have peace, there's no way you will be happy. Peace is the missing ingredient in most people's happiness. And going back to our first week, remember that happy people are at peace with themselves, they're at peace with others, and so often, as we'll see today, happy people are at peace with God. And there's a principle that's just splashed all over the New Testament, and here it is. Peace with God paves the way to peace with ourselves and equips us to make peace with others. Peace with God paves the way to peace with ourselves and equips us to make peace with others. A lot of people who don't have peace with God, they don't understand that God doesn't hold your past against you. And so if that's true, you don't have to hold your past against you either. And if you can forgive yourself, you can forgive other people. And now, if we're here today talking about having peace with God, then what that kind of assumes is that we've got a conflict with God. And we do. We see this all over the New Testament too. There's two parts to having conflict with God. Number one, there's sin. And number two, there's your sin. And by your, I don't mean just yours. I mean yours and mine. And we all have this kind of sin that comes from having relational conflict with God. And we're going to look at that in a minute. But what I mean by that there's two components to conflict with God, there's sin and your sin. I mean there's a micro level to sin and a macro level to sin. And for the macro level and the conflict with God that comes from that, maybe the easiest way to explain it is like this. I'm a U.S. citizen, And there's lots of good that comes with that. So much good that comes with that. There are some things that we'd like to change, certainly, but you know, there are a lot of good things that come along with being a citizen. And in one sense, though, there are other things about citizenship that aren't fair. One thing that's not fair about citizenship is that I don't get an opportunity to choose where I'm a citizen of or from. So if I want to be a citizen of the Bahamas because that's where I want to grow up, I want to grow up in the Caribbean, too bad, right? Because you don't have the choice about citizenship. You're actually born into it. I grew up in a little farm town in northwestern Minnesota, about 20 miles from Canada. And every now and again, my family would go to Canada when I was a boy. And I know, you know, it doesn't seem like a big deal that, you know, going to Canada, but you actually have to pass through a checkpoint. It's not like you're going to South Dakota. You actually have to stop. And sometimes we'd get to the border and the border patrol people would be in a bad mood and they'd be pretty strict. And they'd make you get out of your car and they'd search everything and you'd have to wait. Of course, it made total sense because my dad was a pastor and had two, you know, kids in the back seat. So he just fits the profile of a drug smuggler completely, right? No, just kidding. Not at all. But, you know, that's the thing. You don't have a lot of recourse in that situation to avoid being searched or any of the things you have to that happen at the border, because that's what happens when you're born into one country and not the other. You know, there are things about being a citizen, and sometimes they can seem not that fair about being a citizen of a particular country. And what we all need to understand today, I'm giving you this little analogy, we all need to understand today is that just like being born into a physical nation, we also are all born into a spiritual nation. And the spirituality at the macro level, we learned in the New Testament that we were all born into the nation of sin. And, you know, if you're thinking that doesn't seem fair, well, you know, just remember the analogy. I was born in Wisconsin, not the Bahamas, right? Talk about not being fair. But check this out. The Apostle Paul, who wrote a large part of the New Testament, the Apostle Paul kind of sums this up for us. He wrote this. He said, "Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin. And in this way, death came to all people because all sinned." And see, what that says there is just like you were born into a nation and you didn't get to pick it. You didn't get to choose being born into that nation. We were all born into the nation of sin. And we didn't get to pick that, but we got there through being born into the human race. You'll also notice something else from what Paul wrote, and that's where there's sin, there's death. And that's so true, isn't it, of all of us? Sin actually leads to death. And for sure it leads to spiritual death, but there's a more practical aspect to it too. You know, most of us, The sin that we've been born with and we carry around with us is actually, it is killing us, is leading to our death. We've got sin that's killing our relationships. We've got sin that's killing our futures. You know, sin creates this conflict with ourselves, and it creates a conflict with other people, and it creates this conflict with God. And a lot of us, this sin makes our lives so that we can't even get along with ourselves, right? The sin, it kills our sense of value. It kills our discipline. It kills our self-esteem. It kills our creativity. So death reigns in all of our lives. Death is in control in all of our lives because we were born into this wrong nation of sin, so to speak. And I know this doesn't seem fair. And God doesn't want it either. So God did something. God came along and did something through Jesus Christ to bring a sacrifice, to bring a solution for the sin in our lives. So we don't need to pay for it. God himself has taken upon himself the payment for our sins. It's amazing, isn't it? If you've been around church for any length of time, you've probably seen a diagram something like this one. And it shows on the one side that, you know, we're in this land on one side of this giant chasm or gap. And God is on this other land on the other side of the gap. And we can't get from one side to the other, just like you can't get from one country to the other without getting permission. And so what God has done for us is that He has made a way for us to leave the nation we were born in and to cross over to the other side where He lives in the kingdom of God. And it's like God is saying to us, you know, I'm inviting you to a redo. You know, you were born into this nation of sin, and I'm inviting you to be reborn, if you will, to give you a new passport to a new place. In fact, Jesus told a guy one time whose name was Nicodemus, who came to Jesus at night so that he could avoid being seen. And Jesus told him that, you know, that the only way to get this new life in God, to be at peace with God, was to be reborn into the kingdom of God. And so Nicodemus says something like, well, how can a grown person go back to their mother's womb? You know, to that we say, thanks for going there, dude. Like, I did not need that, right? But what Jesus was talking about was, you know, what we've been saying. We need to be reborn into a new nation. Not the kingdom of sin that you were born into, but the kingdom of righteousness, where you can only get to, you can only go through an act from God Himself. The Apostle Paul, he's trying to explain all this to some people. He wrote this. He said, For God has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Check that out. Check it out. God has a plan for you to have a brand new life and a new way to live. But it has nothing to do with it. It doesn't come about because of your behavior, right? That's not the first thing that has to happen. And it doesn't happen based on a decision that you make, except for allowing God to remake you and to give you a passport into His kingdom. So how is it, you know, knowing all this, how is it that we get this peace with God that we're searching after that leads to peace with ourselves and leads to peace with other people? Again, the Apostle Paul, I told you he wrote a lot of the New Testament. He wrote this. He said, therefore, since we have been justified, justified means made right. It means declared innocent. Therefore, since we've been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. There it is. There it is. Jesus Christ is the passport. Jesus Christ is the means of getting out of the kingdom of sin and into the kingdom of righteousness, of being born into a new kingdom, a new nation. And here it is. Here's what the New Testament really says as it sums it up, is that peace with God begins with faith in Jesus Christ. Peace with God begins with faith in Jesus Christ. It doesn't begin through the language you choose. It doesn't begin with you acting out some new behaviors either. It begins with God granting you access into a new kingdom based on you having faith in Christ. There's been a lot of people who've tried to define faith, but faith really is the hand that accepts the gift of God. God is offering all of us a gift of being reborn and reborn into a new land, a new place, a kingdom of God and a kingdom of righteousness. And faith means simply accepting what God is offering to you. It's as easy as that. Now, let me just for a moment move over to the micro side that I mentioned earlier. There's a macro level we've been talking about, and there's also a micro level, which is is not the sin we were born with, but this is the sin that we've got on a personal level. Let me explain this. You know, a lot of times there's sin that we have on a personal level that destroys our peace with God. And that micro level sin actually kind of looks like a conflict that we have in our homes. You know, those of you who are parents know what this looks like. And if you're a kid, or if you ever were a kid, I think we should have all of our bases covered there if we do that. You know what this looks like too. Sometimes, right? Not all the time, but sometimes. Sometimes kids want their own way, even when it's not a good way. Right? Do you recognize that statement? Kids want their own way, even when it's not a good way. Like, I wanted some stuff when I was a kid that it wasn't great, right? You did too. And if you're parents, you'll see that in your children as well. But, you know, listen, there are times as a parent that you're tempted to absolutely just let your kids have what they want, even when it's not great. You're tempted to let your kids have what they want, even when it's not great, just to keep the peace. Anybody there? Anybody ever experienced that? Maybe you even got your parents to do that. You got them to just like, oh, I just want peace. Fine, go do what you want to do. But as a parent, because you love your kids, when you leave home for the weekend, you don't say to your teenagers, okay, here's the keys to the liquor cabinet and the keys to the car. Have a great time, right? That's not what you say. At least I hope that's not what you say. You know, you don't say, either, well, I'm going to be gone for a couple days, so, you know, why don't you have some people over? Just throw an invite out there on social media. I'm sure it'll just be like a handful of your closest friends. Just have some people over. And by the way, you know, have a great party and don't even bother to clean up. I'll take care of that when I get home, right? That's not what we say. That's not what you say when you love your kids. That's not what you do when you love your kids. Sometimes you say no. When your kids want to do the wrong thing, you as a loving parent say no. And you don't do it because you're a meanie. You do it because you have a love so strong that it won't just go along, right? You love your kids so much that you won't just go along with everything just to keep the peace. And God is like that. In fact, Jesus told people one time, he said, you know, think of God, like I'm going to try to describe this to you. Think of God as the most loving and perfect heavenly Father. That's how you should think about him. Now, I mean, we know God, God is not male. God's not female. God is a spirit. In fact, God is, he's both present with us, but he's also so high above us that sometimes when we try to figure him out, what he's doing, it can kind of make your head, hurt, right? But Jesus said, how can I explain this? Like, let me get as close as I possibly can. Think of God as a loving heavenly Father. You know, when it comes to having peace with God, we have peace with God the same way we have peace with our parents here on earth who love us. It's when they want us to do the right thing, when they want us to do the best thing, there's a way that we have peace with them, and here's how we do it. We said earlier that peace with God begins with faith in Christ, and peace at this micro level, it looks like this. Peace with God is sustained by submission to Christ. That's how you have peace in your home at a micro level with parents and kids. You know, for some of us watching today, maybe even most of us watching today, the issue is not that you've never made a decision to put your faith in Christ so that God could offer you a place in his kingdom of light rather than the kingdom of darkness. Most of us, the reason we don't have peace with God today, if we don't have peace with God, is because we're not currently submitting ourselves to Jesus Christ and the best that he has for us and that he wants for us. Listen, you know, if you're having relational conflict with a parent, you know, you're still their child. If you're having relational conflict with a parent, you're still in the family. You haven't lost your place. It's just that you won't have any peace. When there's relational conflict between a child and a parent, there's no relational peace. And some of us, we know what we need to do to restore our relationship with our Heavenly Father who loves us so much, but we're not doing it. It's almost like we're tiptoeing through the house. When we hear him coming, we go the other way, down the other hallway, or we duck into a room. We know we're not in submission to him. We know we're not doing the right thing, and it's putting us in conflict with him, even right now. But can I just ask you something? What is worth more than peace with your Heavenly Father? None of us want to have peace. None of us want to have conflict in the homes we live in. We certainly don't want to have conflict with the God of the universe. So can I ask you, what is worth more than peace with God? Because here's the thing. God wants to have peace with you. His arms aren't crossed. He's not turning his back on you. In fact, Jesus said that when we turn away from God, he actually comes after us and searches for us to show us that he loves us and to make peace with us. God's in a posture of having his arms wide open to you, even today, even right now, like the loving Heavenly Father that he is. He wants to make peace with you. Do you want to make peace with him? That's the question we all have to answer. Or is there an area of your life that you're just simply not submitting to him and you know it? Are you able to wake up in the morning and say, God, I'm ready to do whatever, whatever you have for me, whatever you want for me today, I'm ready. No reservations. I'll do whatever you have for me. Or do you have reservations? Are there places where you know that you are not submitting to the God who loves you so much and wants nothing more than for you to have peace with him, with yourself, and with others? It's a matter of, do you have peace with God? Because you've submitted every area of your life to him. Because when you have peace with God, you will have peace with yourself and you will have peace with others. In every area of your life, you will experience the happiness that only comes with peace. And when there are areas in your life that aren't submitted to God, there's no peace in other areas of your life either. And so if you're wondering, why do I not have peace in these other areas of my life? It might be because you don't have peace with God. And today is a day that you can change that. If you lack peace with God today, what's keeping you from submitting to him in every area of your life? And what I want to do today is I want to end this message here today. I want to give you a chance to think how, you know, I've never put my faith in Christ. I haven't put my faith in Christ to be taken out of the nation of sin, to be into God's nation of righteousness. I want that peace with God today. Or maybe today it's just that you've got relational conflict with your Heavenly Father because you're not submitting to him. So I want to give you some time today to think about that, to pray about that, and to have God speak to you today. So I want to end this message right here. I want the band to come back today, and they're going to sing a song And while they sing a song, it's called Close. It's about being close to the God who loves us. I want you to think about the ways and the areas of your life where maybe you're not close. Maybe there is relational conflict, and let God speak to you. And after the band sings and plays, we'll come back together again and we'll pray together.
I wanna be close to you.
My heart.
worship you. Oh, my life surrender, my heart abandoned for more of you.
You know, I love the words of that song the band just played. My life surrendered, my heart abandoned for more of you. If that's you today, if you want to surrender your life, if you want to live your life for God with abandon, just give Him everything, then let's pray together today. And it's not about the words, it's about the condition of your heart. If you want to commit your life to God today, you can do it even here and even right now. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this word today about how we can have peace with you. God, for anybody watching today, for anyone who's not put their faith in you and is realizing, you know, I was born into this kingdom of darkness and sin, and I've never said, God, rescue me from this. I'm putting my faith in Jesus, and I want to follow you. God, may today be that day. May that be the prayer of anyone watching today who has never put their faith in you. And God, I pray for the rest of us today who we have made a commitment to you, but just like a parent and a child, we're still in your family, but we've got relational conflict with you because we're resisting you and we're resisting being submitted to you. You've got the best for us. You've got the good for us in mind, and we're resisting you in some way. And now today, God, you've put that on our mind. And we know, we see, we understand the places we've been resisting you. God, help our prayer today to be, Lord, I want to do whatever you want me to do. I want to have peace with you. I want to have a vibrant life with you. And so today I surrender my life and my heart is abandoned to you. Give me more of you. God, we pray this in your name and in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. If you committed your life today, if you're watching online on our website, let us know that. Click the I Commit button and we'll send you some resources that will help you in your new life, in the kingdom of God. And it will come alongside you, let you know how to live this brand new life. If you're watching on Facebook today, just text I Commit to 970000. And we would love to, again, come alongside of you and help you as you begin to walk with Jesus Christ. I hope you guys have a great week. It was great to see you. And don't forget, next Sunday, Father's Day, we'll be hearing a great message from a brand new father. And we'll see you then.
Thanks so much for being at Resonate today. Don't forget to sign up for an in-person meetup. And if you're interested in being baptized, register for a Q&A session happening at 11 a.m. today. You can find all the information at resonatebuzz.com. We hope today has been a blessing to you, and we hope today has been the best day of your week. We look forward to seeing you here next Sunday at Resonate Community Church.